Work in progress, here comes Johnny Yen again, or How I Kicked Punk. Working on the railroad, smoking way too much opium. I was the fall of a dynasty, a queer junkie's fantasy. I was a punk rock punchline, repurposed as the jingle for a cruise line. I've lived over 1 billion lives, died many more times, never seen the sunrise, but you'll see my face in every sunset, 'cause I was the all-American Chinaman who used to go by Johnny Yen again. Johnny Yen again. This is opium. This is OPM. In the West and through the ages, opium was distilled into heroin and sold on the streets with such names as Junk, Smack, Horse, H, Black Crystal, Black Pearl, China White, and Chinese Red. This is OPM. In the West and through the ages, this was also distilled but sold in supermarkets and online with such marketing monikers as Sesame Cracker Smackdown, Wasabi Pea Party, and of course its flagship OPM brand name, Oriental Party Mix. This is processed junk. This is processed junk food. Back in the 20th century, it was often said that religion is the opiate of the masses. But now in the 21st century, have the masses become the opiate of religion? But what about the people of the opium? Before we can speak truth to power, we must first speak truth to powder. And yes, the Chinese supposedly invented opium powder. And yes, the Chinese supposedly invented gunpowder. But by all accounts, the invention of gunpowder was really the botched byproduct of Chinese alchemists trying to create fire of life elixir medicine. Kind of like Columbus discovering America while trying to find new trade routes to the West Indies. Both had the same kind of impact on its own people, whatever its own means anymore. Now, we all know the carnage that gunpowder and guns have had on this planet. Lesser discussed or less known is the carnage that colonialism, along with opium, have had on this world. And it all goes back to those trade routes. Great Britain tried to expand its market share of China by dumping shipload after shipload after shipload of opium onto China. China resisted, but Great Britain's defeat of China back in the 19th century for the first opium war was the biggest humiliation in Chinese history. That defeat left China permanently open to the West against her will. It was almost like a battle of the powder powers. And China's gunpowder was no match for Great Britain's opium powder. But as the late, great Leonard Cohen sings, there was a crack in everything, and that's how the light gets in. So even though China was completely destroyed by the opium wars, ironically, a decimated Qing dynasty that could not control its border and keep its own people on the inside was the crack through which many Chinese escaped their extreme poverty and their low status to come to America, like my grandfather. My grandfather ultimately died of an opium overdose just a few blocks from here on the streets of New York's Chinatown, but make no mistake about it. He was a casualty of the opium wars, and you could never underestimate the impact of opium on China, the Chinese diaspora, and most profoundly on the Chinese psyche and soul. How this trickled down to my generation, growing up in 1970s New York City counterculture, was punk rock. Growing up, we Asian Americans didn't have many role models. Remember, this is before Awkwafina. Before Andrew Yang. Does anyone remember Jeremy Lin? Linsanity? So when I heard that Iggy Pop David Bowie song, Lust for Life, and that opening line, here comes Johnny Yen again. I thought Johnny Yen has to be a Chinese character. Turns out that while Iggy and Bowie made this great song, Johnny Yen was not their creation. They were paying homage to that singular icon of queer and junkie literature, William S. Burroughs. Though Iggy really embellished the Johnny part, Johnny was his drug dealer. Johnny Yen first appears in Burroughs' 1962 novel, The Ticket That Exploded. And to me, Burroughs' conception of Johnny Yen is just that, the yen, the urge, the need for drugs. The yearn, the urge, the need for sex. Basically, anytime you feel the urge, the need, or the want, to do something, to do someone, to do something or to say someone that may not be in your best long-term interest. That's Johnny Yen. Now, as a teenager, I could never fully grasp the junkie side of Johnny Yen, but I completely embraced the punk side. Punk rock became my opium. It was how I survived, how I coped. Overnight, my entire wardrobe became black. All my fingernails were painted black. And me and my friend Ray Wong were the only members of the band who didn't have to dye our hair black. I lived the punk rock defiance. And in many ways, I still do. For better and for worse. But that was back then, when life was cheap and heroin was chic. Now don't get me wrong, nobody wanted to be an addict, but everybody wanted to live as if they were a heroin chic junkie. In 1970s New York City, to live as if you were a heroin chic junkie was akin to being a stone flaneur or Boulevardier. But rather than promenading up and down the Champs-Élysées, these heroin chic junkies, they ruled the Bowery before it was shishi, when it was still funky but chic. Now you can follow funky all the way until it becomes chic. You can rule the Bowery until you're on the Champs-Élysées, you'll still wind up at the intersection of opium and OPM. At least that's where too many Chinese Americans wound up, trying to navigate this existential conundrum of becoming a cliched, caricatured, compromised commodity, or living a fringe existence, trying to grab glimpses of the dream from between the clouds. The late great Allen Ginsberg might have said, one option offers consciousness without a body. The other, a body without consciousness. Between opium and OPM also lies the road. And back when Johnny Yen again first got out on the road, they said all you need are three chords and the truth. But life is way too short for three chords. Life is way too short for the truth. That's why Johnny Yen again got off the road. Off the road, it's two chords. It's two chords and the true. The final TH is silent. Because the end of truth is always silence. But in that silence, you take a few turns and you realize maybe it's easier to always try to find your way outside rather than to keep fighting to get inside. Because what is inside? What is outside? What do you want? What do you need? Haven't they all been inside, outside, and besides the point way too many times? Silenced voices, violent choices, stolen cultures, spirit vultures, old world orders, new world borders. What did you want? What did you want? What did you make? What did you make? Rights, air rights, signify, occupy, represent, circumvent, no accents, no dissent, tolerate, desecrate, reappropriate, appreciate. What did you want? What did you take? What did you break? What did you break? Was it worth it? And was it worth it? Was it worth it? Maybe that's why my grandfather, like so many Chinese in America in the early 20th century, they chose, consciously or subconsciously, to become permanent outsiders through opium. See, they never expected to be accepted here in the United States of America. Of course, there's also that tiny little legal obstacle known as the Chinese Exclusion Act. From 1882 to 1943, the Chinese Exclusion Act was the first, and God help us, the last American law that made it illegal for one race of people to become citizens here. On so many other levels, my grandfather accepted that these American means and laws would limit his livelihood. He accepted that these American means and laws would limit his manhood. But he made a pledge. These same American means and laws would never ever touch his soul. His soul was all his, floating in a cloud of opium, trying to survive on the inside while getting completely disenfranchised on the outside. it's funny. Powder has no edge, yet it's what we humans take in every form to get that edge, any edge. To my grandfather, you might say opium was his punk rock. It was his show of defiance to his outsider status. This is how he processed his identity, how he processed his station. Before there was Oriental Party Mix in the strange land known as the United States of America. As for me, I no longer exist on a plane where opium or OPM can touch me. I'm off the road now and back inside your head where I began. You might say, I've finally kicked punk. But while you think you may have forgotten about me, oh, you know me. Anytime you feel the urge, the need, the want to do something, do someone, say something, be someone that may not be in your best long-term interest, here comes Johnny N again. Now I say long term because, let's face it, in the short term, there's nothing like satisfying that old Johnny N again. Now is there? That's why I remain the yellow man in black with the guitar on my back and the opium in my soul and my off-white rock and roll. I only roll by moon glow, but I know which way the wind blows. 'Cause I was an all-American Chinaman who used to go by Johnny Yen again. Johnny Yen again. I do all the wrong things right, and I could be yours tonight. Johnny Yen again. Johnny Yen again. Thank you. And celebrate a few things, and I guess if you're going to talk about punk rock, raconteurs, it all goes back to Lou Reed in many ways. So we're going to celebrate Lou, but also we're also going to gather as we have our good friends from Slant, and also we're all New York people, and all many of us are Asian American artists. And a quick announcement: there was a tragic fire in Chinatown the night before Lunar New Year this year at 70 Mulberry Street. And so there's a great fundraiser happening, and our friend Perry Young was part of that. And before you leave, we have flyers. Hope you consider making a donation. There's a QR code where you can do that. And it's just one of the hearts of our community. It was at 70 Mulberry Street. They housed the H.C. Chen Dance Center. I was lucky to perform part of the Last Emperor Flushing there, and the Museum of Chinese in America, their archives are there, and so many great organizations are there. So if you could, we'll have some flyers at the end. If you consider making a donation, that'd be wonderful. And you can follow Perry on there then too. He's doing a thing there. So, and in many ways, what we're gonna do is, so he was such a big influence on all of us, but towards the end of his life, Lou Reed was also really devoted to Tai Chi. And what the connections we make are, Lou always said that for his music, it was simple, but not simple-minded. And I feel like that goes for Tai Chi also. So now I want you to help me welcome our great friends, great artists, Rick Ibarra and Perry Young from the Slant Performance Group. And the woman who gives new meaning to in-house director, in-house dramaturg, Wendy Wazell.
Yen, some Tai Chi, slow, sustained movement. Follow me, do your own thing.
Guys, I have a microphone right here.
Thank you. Happy birthday, Lou. We miss you. Wendy Lovedog. Ricky Mahara. Terry Young. Dixon Place. Thank you.